my God, we've spoken already. I get, this is gonna be chaos. Just watch. Yep. Hey everybody, it's Nerdicane. Doing Forza League again. This was fun. I was looking forward to this so much because of the cars that they chose. I didn't even do the Sport Compact. Starting off here, if I raced against you, give me a shout out. Hey, thanks for racing clean. This is the 53 Corvette. Yes, it is the first Corvette, but just watch this. The starting of these races in the Corvette, I chuckle every time because this car is just so underpowered for what it was. Here's me bumping a guy named Zaz. I apologize for that. To him on the mic, and then you kind of get tangled up with a group again, and he gets spun because of me, but I bumped him back, and I gave him a spot, so just, you know, just trying to keep it clean, keep good etiquette. We were pretty much last, but he was a really good racer. I actually enjoyed racing alongside him. I wound up overtaking him, because these are momentum cars. You need to be... This 56 Corvette had an inline six. It was very underpowered. So you really need momentum and not to hit tires like I just did. I just whacked those tires and pretty much killed my race. And then another dude did it right behind me. That's a really interesting sequence of turns right there. I really love those turns. But I like this track too. I like when you get into it and it's set to rain. The transition from your normal weather to rain is a lot of fun. I really like that part of it. But here it is. I managed to pull back fifth or fourth. A lot of people dropped, and I rarely ever drop a race, but that's pretty much where it ended up. I did pretty well on this one. Going to the next track, once again, if you see your name on here, give me a shout out. Say hey, and don't be a stranger. But we're doing the Corvettes again. Getting back to it. So a guy named Harley Earl spent some time in Europe, and he kept seeing European roadsters, and there was really nothing like this in the American market, and he felt that we needed something like this on the American market, so he started up the prototype, and they showed it at the at a car show in New York, and the heads of Chevrolet were like, we love it, we love the look, it's exciting, built, they rushed it into production, and they put a stipulation on it that kind of killed it. It could have killed this car. They said, okay, everything that you make this car out of, except the body, needs to be off-the-shelf parts. It needs to be stuff that is already in production on cars in their line. So that's where we wound up with the Blue Flame Inline 6, which was a really good engine for a car, just not a good engine for a sports car. So this car hit the shelves, and the first year, I think they made like 300 handmade fiberglass. This was the first car to use fiberglass reinforced plastic on the bottom. That's why you get that shape. That's why it's extremely light and fun to drive. So they hit the mark on that, but the car just didn't have any power, and they had trouble selling it. They sold like less than a third. For the first 2 years, they sold less than a third. No, more than a third went unsold the first 2 years, because the first year you could only get it white. And it was only like this. There was no hard top for it. There was no convertible top. If you were going to drive your Corvette, you were going to drive your Corvette in the sun. There was no top to put on. So invest in hats. But it wasn't until 55 that it got a V8. And then 56, it got the redesign that we know. And the 56 Corvette is just a legendary car. It just launched what Corvette is today. Which is the American supercar. God, that sounds so... I feel dirty saying that because I'm a Ford guy and I prefer Fords, but there's no denying that the Corvette is the American supercar at that level. Going to Prague. I love Prague. I really love it in this car because when they picked this car, I knew it was underpowered and I knew it didn't start well. And I was like, man, well, this is... I was interested. I was thinking, why did they pick this car? But then driving Prague, it kind of dawned on me, is this is a precision momentum car. You need to keep your lines, you need to keep your momentum. you're not spoiled with horsepower or handling. So you need to keep your momentum going and going and going. Otherwise, you're going to slip up and you're going to fall behind. I think this is a spot where I slip up. I love the sequence of turns, but I got a little crazy on it. And I think I got passed. Yeah, I did get passed. So, and then I screwed up again. I followed one screw up with another screw up. I kind of got out of my head. But that's racing. You don't leave the race because of that. And I'll show you why here in a second. Too many people in these lead races, if they slip up, they jump out. I rarely ever do it because stuff like this can happen. Two guys in front of me got tangled up trying to pass each other, and I wound up winning the race. Very unlikely. I didn't think I was going to win the race, but I was just sitting back hoping something would happen, and it did. I got first place. Going to these cars, this is the 39 Maserati. These cars, first off, I'll say I love driving this car. I love these because it's the roots of racing. This is very old school. Basically, if you meet anybody, I don't think there's any of these drivers alive because this is a 1939 race car. But man, if you ever meet any of the GP drivers from the 50s and the 60s, if those guys are still alive, man, shake their hands because these cars were bloody dangerous. They used drum brakes. They wanted to cut down on weight so much that there was no seatbelts. Really no safety cages. These guys didn't wear helmets. They wore those like leather bomber helmets and goggles. That was basically it. The fuel was dangerous. They didn't have rupture-proof fuel tanks like they did before. Here's me making a huge mistake. In 1939, that would have been a dead driver. I would have been dead. But fortunately, this is a simulation. So here we go again. This guy, this is why this turn right here on this track is so important. That sequence. And it's a little weird because you're coming out of a dust storm into it. But having the line is so important. As you see, I just got by him. And then I get crazy. I get offline and I rub the side. And he gets by me. Later on, I overtake him again. I had better straight line speed than he did, but he was faster in a turn. He was faster in the beginning of a turn. Coming out of a turn, I was faster. So that you'll see a little later that he gets a little desperate to pass me again, and he winds up making a mistake. He goes into the wall there. Getting back to these cars, God, they were dangerous. They were racing, they say back in this era, and in the 60s, and from that, the 40s to the 60s, they like to say racing was deadly and sex was safe. And it's very true. I've read a lot of books on the history of GP racing, basically before we had Formula One. And yeah, these races were friggin' dangerous. People died all the time. The 1961 book. There's a book on the 1961 GP series called The Limit. Phil Hill, who was the first American to win the Grand Prix Championship, man, you read the book and it's got a higher body count than like a Friday the 13th movie. There's just drivers dying left and right. So it's an interesting thing to look up, and it's something that if you're a race fan, you really should know, because it's the history of the sport. And here we go into the next one. I forget how I finished on this one. Getting to news. I mean, are we done? I think we're done. Well, not we. I think in general the public is done with the being mad at Lewis Hamilton over his boys don't wear dresses comment. And it's kind of indicative of what a weird society we live in right now, where saying something like that could cause controversy. And we're just like, oh my God, I can't believe he said boys don't wear dresses. Boys don't wear dresses. Sorry if that offends you, but they don't. I'll just say this real quick. You know who does all that gender neutrality and all that gender fluidity stuff in Children who talks about that and preaches that, people who don't have children. Because if you have a child, you want your child to be a normal part of society, to where other children will play with your child and there's nothing really weird or just messed up in their child, in their upbringing. So that's all you want for a child. So all this controversy over Lewis Hamilton, it was stupid, it was a flash in the pan, it really carried no weight and no real teeth to it. Plus, I imagine some people like called for him to be fired, and he's a good driver, he's a great driver. He wins a lot of races, and any given weekend in a Formula One race, there's maybe 5 or 6 people in the world who can win a Formula One race, and he's one of them, and he's one of the top ones. Yeah, calling for his job, it's not going to work. They're just going to laugh at you and be like, yeah, whatever, go away. Getting more to that, Formula E ran in Chile the other day. They ran one race, which was really weird to me. Why would you go all that way, set up the track, and then only do one race? My boy Sam Bird, had a crash in practice, but came back and finished 5th in the race. I can't remember the name of the guy who won it. Overall, Sam is sitting 3rd overall in the standings after Chile. I'm saying it right here. I'm claiming it right now. Sam Bird is going to win the championship. He's going to win the championship. So, Sam, just keep doing what you're doing. You're going to win the championship, okay? And when you win, I just want a t-shirt or a hat or something, okay? WRC is starting up. I love Rally, and I could never understand why Rally isn't bigger here in America. It really is more of the roots of NASCAR than what we currently call the Sprint Cup NASCAR or whatever it's called now. Rally should catch on. Rally should be much, much bigger here in America, but for some crazy reason, it isn't. NASCAR is starting up as well. I respect NASCAR. I just don't like watching. I think it's very boring. But NASCAR is starting up soon. And the big news is Grid Girls. What in the world? Where did this come from? I guess maybe sort of a fallout over Lewis Hamilton. They were worried that F1 would seem like this toxic masculinity, misogynistic thing. And it's not. Grid Girls have always been a thing in racing. That book that I mentioned, there's some very funny stories about Grid Girls. And one guy in Brazil, he won his first race, and basically right after the race, he disappeared with the trophy girl and wasn't seen for days, and he missed the flight to go back to the next race. I think the next race is in Italy. He missed the flight, and he had to get on the boat with the car and make it back that way because he was fooling around with the grid girl. It's stupid. If you're hot and you're trying to make a living being hot, it's not easy. But taking away that exposure and that ability to make a little bit of a living on that, it's really unfair. I really think it's just not fair to the women. If they're not being exploited, let them have at it. You know, people enjoy it. It's been tradition for years. Get off of the case. But yeah, this race, I think I won this race. There was only 2 people in this race, which I didn't think they would start a race with just 2 people in it, but I guess they do. But I've enjoyed this week. I've won quite a few races. I'm still in the enthusiast. I'm glad I'm not in grassroots. Grassroots is a nightmare. But basically after that turn, after I got by him, that was the end of it. I had much better straight line speed, and I had tuned the car better for the track, so I basically just ran. But, yeah, that's it. I may do another video this week with some of the sport car in the other car in this class. But thanks for watching. Thanks for your time. I'm Nerdicane. I'm getting better every week. And, hey, maybe I'll get sponsored someday. Get a free wheel or a hat. I don't know, a t-shirt. But thanks for watching. Have a good week. I'll see you out there on the track. Bye.